not live. Okay, because when we are going to have the electric vehicles, right now we don't have correct battery technology. Okay, the battery life of the batteries are not that great. Okay, if the battery life is going to come down, okay, how we are going to handle so much of e-waste those vehicles are going to generate? So yeah, in front of us there is a huge challenges are there, and of course I believe those are the huge opportunity for institutes and the newcomers. Okay, again, the electric vehicle technology, even though it will see its daylight, I think it cannot sustain for more than 15 or 20 years. Or as an electric concept, it will survive, but the more add-ons will be start coming. The one is connectivity. Okay, the connectivity is the biggest buzzword. Already many companies started offering the connectivity options. Okay, companies like Robert Bosch are selling the connectivity kits today. Okay, but the biggest question, what is the money that a direct automobile company can make out of this connectivity? Okay, with the connectivity kit, I'll give a connectivity kit to you. Okay, so what is the money that I'm going to make out of that connectivity kit as an automobile company? We don't have an answer. Okay, and if you see the connectivity, what are all the things it can do? A connectivity thing, actually it can interact, a vehicle can interact with an infrastructure, a vehicle can interact with another vehicle, okay, something like an automated supply chain thing it can do, an onboard diagnosis it can do, okay, as well as automatic freight matching it can do. So all these things are there, the capability is there, but how an automobile company can make money out of it directly? So we don't have the straight answers now. And one more thing on the connectivity front. The one simple thing that we can do is, I don't know whether you heard of this terminology called platooning. The platooning is nothing but three vehicles, one after another, can travel on a highway. Okay, because of the thrust, the force that it is going to come, actually the vehicle, the three vehicles together can save 10 to 11% of on fuel. Okay, but today imagine a highway, an Indian highway, whether a three truck can go together on back to back, which is not possible. So with the connectivity on one side, the lack of infrastructure on another side, we are having the difficulty to make use of it. Okay, and again, with the connectivity things, what one company can claim is on total cost of ownership. This is a buzzword which any of these commercial vehicles, not only trucks I will say, but also the buses or the taxi kind of cars, all those things, all those manufacturers claim is on the lowest total cost of ownership. How much you are going to save on total cost of ownership? That is the buzzword there. Okay, using this connectivity as a technology, you need to reduce the cost of ownership. Okay, so this is where the focus will be after some time. Okay, when the connectivity is going to take up, then come the last thing is on connected cars. On autonomous driving. Recently, our central minister, he made one statement that we will not allow autonomous cars. Okay, but actually the companies never stopped working. Okay, even the work is going on how we can make the autonomous driving vehicles. Okay, when the vehicle become more electric, more connected, that we can easily achieve this autonomous driving. Okay, because day by day we have scarcity for drivers. Okay, even nowadays, even if we make thousands of truck, okay, for each truck to transport each truck, company needs a driver. Okay, so there is a huge demand for driver. especially the mining segments and all, if you see, each drivers are highly paid, like they will be earning 50,000, 60,000 per month. Okay, so most complex things. So autonomous driving makes sense in future. Okay, this is whatever I said so far is on technology per se. Okay, but on the other side, the number of vehicles the country is getting increased day by day. Okay, see the case of Delhi. We are talking about high pollution levels. Okay, now itself in one of the state in front of us is implementing a odd even rule. Okay, so technically they want to reduce the number of the automobile or the cars that we are using. Okay, so there is another possibility in future. That is, a person should not own a car. Or a car should be owned by a group of people. Okay, the insurance may become costly. Okay, it is easy for us to hire a car or to do a car pooling rather than owning a car. Okay, so today the game is on volumes. How much volume I'm going to make? That much big money I'll be making. But on future, my volumes will absolutely come down if this trend continues. Okay, on electrification one side, the pollution level can come down. Okay, but again, our roads are not having much of capability to take the heavy traffic. If this continues, the volume is going to come down. Okay, if the volume is going to come down, today all my suppliers, they depend on volumes. Especially for me today, even today also, maintaining a casting and forging supplier, especially for a smaller size parts of less than 2 kg, is a very big challenge. Okay, most of the times our line stops because of castings and forgings today. Imagine today if tomorrow if the volume is going to drop, okay, what will we end up in? Okay, the mindset of manufacturing is not going to work. Probably something like a 3D printing. Okay, today they look like, those words look like fantasy. Okay, but while moving on, these things are very, very important. Whoever is going to be a leader in those technology is going to survive. Okay, so automobile is going to be something like, we see the next 4 generations is going to be like this, okay, with lot of challenges. Technology is going to be technology is going to play a bigger role, and whoever is going to have the technology is going to be the game winner. Okay, that's all. Few thoughts about what is happening in the automotive industry. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for very much valuable insights. That is very helpful. Before we continue with the introduction, I would like to call upon Purushottam sir also here, who is from Ford, and I'd like to call him on stage. Welcome, sir. So, sir, I would like you to introduce yourself and briefly your journey in Ford and how it has been.
Hello everyone, this is Purushottam. Previously, before joining VLM, I was working with Ashok Leland. I'm a 2011 GET of Ashok Leland. Initially, after the GET phase of training, I joined their engine R&D department. So I was looking into the emission calibration and emission certifications of engines. Post VLM, I've joined Ford Motors, specifically into the project management of prototype builds of cars. I work for the North American market of proto build and proto development. In Ford, rather than talking about journey in Ford, I would like to discuss the differences between an Indian organization and an MNC in India. So, of course, Ford focus is right now more in technology, as our senior Divakar said. They're not focusing more on volumes than now how is Maruti or Hyundai is focusing on. market share is definitely not their piece of cake. Rather, they know the future, where it is going to be. They know like connected cars and AVs and EVs, autonomous vehicles and electric vehicles will definitely catch up the future. And hence, they are focusing more on implementing AVs and EVs specifically into the Indian market. So that's how is their development right now into. As such, Ford is slowly capturing the Indian market. Right now, it's a meager of 4%, I would say. But then that slow improvement is actually very much important, as I would say, into the Indian market. More than the manufacturing, what we see here, the manufacturing, what you guys would be seeing in Japan as well, it is, I guess, the future is more headed beyond that. Ford is actually focusing more into virtual factory, all these things which you guys are studying right now, 3D printing, IoTs in the plants. All these things are right now implemented. It is no more a story or no more a future or a vision what you see. It is already implemented. The work you guys will be doing is how would you implement in a low-cost scale or how would you implement in a context to the Indian manufacturing. So that's how your scope will be with respect to an MNC organization present in India. It's been a very good journey. And I'm looking to work for different functions in Ford. So that's all.
Thank you, sir.
I would like Manak sir now to address you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for welcoming me here. I guess I didn't come prepared, so I had time to prepare while they were speaking. So good about that. I would like to just brief you on my journey from the start of my career. I finished my BE in 2006, and I joined Ashok Leyland as a GET. In 2013-14, I joined VLM. Before that, I had experiences in manufacturing and supply chain for quite a while. And after VLM, I went back to Ashok Leyland. I was sponsored. I went back as the EA2 MD. I worked there for a year, and after that, I joined marketing. In marketing, I basically take care of product management group, where basically it's about going to markets, studying that, doing analysis, taking the customers, voice of customers, and then making that requirement into specifications, and then giving it to PD for product development. That's where I come in. So there are a couple of things which I would like to speak. Do you have time? So, okay, I'll just cut short to one topic. I would like to just brief you guys on the major initiative which our company is taking. One of them is called Modular Business Program. It's called MBP in short. So what does MBP stand for? Can anyone guess what MBP stand for? Can I get someone from the audience to have a word about it? Yeah. So how does it work? It works like a Lego block. Currently, I have a vehicle which has several aggregates, the gearbox, the axles, the propeller shaft, the wheels, the frames, and so many things. So I'm commonizing across the various aggregates in the vehicle so that I can mix and match and give the customers anything which he wants. That's basically the funda of MVP. So how does it work? People might just think that it's about R&D, because if I commonize the interfaces and commonize the various aggregates, I will be able to give the customers various customization options. But that's not the case. I would like to just take you through the advantages of MBP across the entire value chain of the company. So let me start with the operations. If I have the similar products which I get manufactured again and again, I get an economy of my efficiency increases, my economy of scale increases. In supply chain, I'll be able to procure the same component which is meant for various vehicles in a bulk. So economy of scale increases, I'll be able to get the vehicle at the component at a much better rate. In case of marketing, I can provide my customers whatever he wants. He has basically got to log into my website and just pick and choose what aggregates he wants, and I can give the vehicle to him within a very short time. So that's going to, you know, make the whole value chain very efficient, because I don't have to keep stranger components. I can have a lot of common components. That's what we are doing in our company as well. Fourth thing which is very advantageous is on the aftermarket service. So when the vehicle breaks down in a remote area, I don't have to keep too many stranger components for a particular vehicle. I can have a common component and I can serve that particular vehicle. So I have covered about operations, marketing, aftermarket design. So all these things will get transformed. Now, added to what Divakar said about electric vehicles, the number of aggregates are going to reduce drastically, because I'm not going to have any FIPs, no engines, gearbox is going to be very much simplified. So this modular vehicle concept clubbed with electric vehicle is going to come in next 2 or 3 years. Is going to be a game changer. And if a company can actually be efficient and effective, only that can survive in the market. Right. So that's about it. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak to you. I wish you all the very best. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Mena. Manas is one of our seniors whom we had a chance to interact during our initial days at IIM. So I welcome you again, Manas.
Thank you. Good evening, sir. Welcome, sir, IIT Madras. Myself, Manas Vyas, before VLM, joining VLM, I had about 6 years of experience in aluminum sector, mostly four and a half of it was in Vedanta Aluminium Limited, and almost one year at Hindalco, the other aluminum plant. Only aluminum sector, aluminum company I left was Nalco. Post MBA, I got an opportunity to work with the TVS Logistics Services Limited, now TVS Supply Chain Solutions, under the DM. I'm executive assistant to the DMD there, and if I work to divide my time into the work that I'm actually doing there, I would say 70% of my time goes into the supply chain excellence initiative, mainly driving the PDC and SDCA cycle. You might already have heard of what is PDC and what is SDCA cycles in different divisions of the logistics. Now, logistics does not talk only, we do not mean by logistics only transportation and trucks running here and there from point A to point B, but it is more into the supply chain solutions part of it, the solutioning on understanding the customer requirement and giving them the solution. The same funda that we had studied at IIT Kanpur by the name of design thinking. And it covers about how can we bring the best out of the existing resources, as well as what else can be added to it to optimize the cost benefit of it. Let's say I apply 10 rupees to my existing supply chain, and if I earn 12 out of it, that is what optimization is. So what should I pull into my supply chain so that I can get the best out of the supply chain? And I mostly work on warehouses. Currently, I'm working mostly on warehouses. And the second leg would be working on telecom log-